please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for a nice introduction. I really want to show you some aspects of microswitches in G-protein coupled receptors. We concentrated this time on opioid receptors. But let me start from general aspects. So far, we know only three structures of G-protein coupled receptors, although there are about 800 types of them. As Philip mentioned, about 50% of currently available drugs are known against them. So first structure known was crystallized in 2000 by Chris Palczewski laboratory, and then we have to wait 7 years for the next structure. It was beta 1 and beta 2 adrenergic receptors. The structures are nearly the same. And in 2008, adenosine A to A receptor was crystallized. For this year, two new structures are scheduled. This is dopamine receptor D3 and one of chemokine receptors. And as you see, the transmembrane part of these receptors are nearly the same. They consist of 7 transmembrane domains. Here they are colored from blue, this one, helix 1, to red, helix 7. And there is a small helix 8 parallel to the membrane. In some cases, there are palmitoyl chain. This is the anchor of this protein in the membrane. And what is the difference? The difference is N-terminal part. This is extracellular part. For instance, here, this is strictly covered the retinal in the binding site. The rhodopsin is an exception among GPCRs because the ligand is covalently bound to this helix 7. And this is why the cover is rather very, very, very solid. The difference is here. These are diffusible ligands, so they have to go in and go out rather quickly. And as you see, this is the loop between helices 4 and 5. In this case, this is the short helix. Here is a beta sheet similarly to this one, but this is the open case. Currently, there are many different theories about activation of GPCRs, and this is one of them, very recent. It was published this year by Brian Kobilka. And this is important guy because he crystallized beta 1 and beta 2 adrenergic receptors, and he's still very active in the field. So he proposed that there is no defined structure of basic state of GPCR without ligand, and upon binding an agonist or inverse agonist and possibly also antagonist, the shape is changing. In case of agonist, regardless of the binding site, this is allosteric, close to the close to the outer surface of the receptor, and this is orthosteric site, closer to the center of the protein, the change of the shape is similar, so it allows binding of G protein that is transmitting signal to the cell. In case of inverse agonist, change of the shape is different, so there is no possibility for G protein to bind to this receptor and pass the signal. Unfortunately, for this scheme, one thing is missed, because it was found that the activation of the receptor can be also passed toward beta arrestin. So there is another way of passing the signal. So in some cases, substances that are inverse agonists for passing the signal via G protein, they are agonists for beta arrestin. So the situation is really complicated. How this change of the shape is done? It is done, of course, not at once, in one nano or picosecond. It requires at least 1 millisecond, and they are performed by action of different so-called micro switches. So upon binding of the ligand, some micro switches, some positions of the ligands are changing. For instance, here, this is so-called rotamer switch. It involves movement of tryptophan on helix 6. Yeah, so this is small movement, but very important for the change of the structure of the receptor. Another rotamer switch is here. It involves hydrophobic interaction between helix 8 and 7. This is phenylalanine and tyrosine. And upon activation, this is assumed that there is a movement from here to here. As I mentioned, there are two ways of passing the signal. So in some cases, it is not known which state is on and off. So this can be missing. Water is also important because this is passing the signal of state on or off to another set of microswitches. Apart from rotamer switches, there are bridges, bridging interaction between helices. Like here, this is arginine. Arginine in helix 3 is interacting with helix 6, not shown here. This is so-called ionic bridge. And another switch is very close to the ligand position, not shown here. There are only main microswitches. So it is bridging helices 3 and 7. It will be shown later on the opioid receptor structures. So we modeled three of opioid receptors, mu, delta, and kappa, and did some molecular dynamic simulations. We used two templates available at that time, rhodopsin template and beta-2-adrenergic receptor template. Here I show only two types, delta and kappa opioid receptors. So we used homology modeling method, and as you see, we used this method for the whole structure, and the N-terminal part is typical for the template. Here is beta sheet, so it comes from rhodopsin. Here is the helix, it comes from adrenergic receptor. This is, of course, error. So we changed this method. We used homology modeling only for the transmembrane part, and here we used another method. This is ab initio method, CABS. This is coarse grain method. It means it involves only alpha, beta, and one grain for the side chain. And we use this method to test how it works, and we predicted structures of N-terminal part, especially this helix, which is visible in the crystal, for beta 1, beta 2, adenosine receptor, and also for N-terminal part of the rhodopsin. So you can see the structures are nearly similar, so we can trust that this method is good. So we predicted the structure of opioid receptors and docked the ligands, antagonists and agonists, about 10 different ligands, and we found that antagonists preferred to bind to helix 3, to two adjacent residues. This is aspartic acid and tyrosine, and we used very stiff ligands. They are analogs of morphine, and they contain very similar groups. This is protonated nitrogen. It is binding via ionic interactions. And this is tyramine group. This is binding by hydrogen bonds. So let me show some. Okay. As you see here, position of the ligand is stable, and nothing is happening about thermal motion, as you see here. However, agonists are binding to the same aspartic acid here, but to histidine on helix 6. There's a small movement, as you see, from that residue to this residue, but very important things is happening here. There is a break of the bridge between helix 3 and 7 of this residue. So there is action of the microswitch. We found also the action of another switch. When we forced antagonist, this is naltrexone, to bind to histidine here, we found a change of the state of two switches. The first one is the bridge here, you know this, between helices 3 and 7, and also the rotamer switch of the tryptophan located on helix 6. This is vertical position, this is horizontal position. So not only the structure of the ligand, but its position is important for the starting activation of the receptor. This is the same ligand, antagonist, but here is in typical antagonist position, and here is in position of agonists. And this is the second switch. Okay. So the movement of the ligand in the binding site is really small. This is about 2 angstroms, but this is enough to completely change action of the receptor. We also modeled, of course, morphine. This is typical ligand of myopioid receptor, and we found that the morphine, this is the smallest of the ligand we analyzed, activates both switches, this one, bridge, and this one, rotamer toggle switch. It involves, in fact, movement of sign change, not only the tryptophan, but located here on another turn of the helix, the histidine. So this is called sometimes extended rotamer toggle switch. And this is location of 2 switches. On the left is scheme of activation I said before, and this is the motion of the ligand. So this is bound to helix 6, as you see. There's a transient binding to helix 3, you will see in a moment. But this is very transient, as you see, and there is no change of the position of the ligand. And here is the bridge. So it will be break in a moment. Oh, now this is breaking, and this position is now stable. This is just starting point of the next activation of the receptor. To check if this sensor that we discovered is working well, we did simulations of very similar structures of antagonists and agonists. These are 5' and 6' GNTI. This is guanosine naltrindol. So the structure and also properties are the same. They contain 2 positive charges for positively charged nitrogens here, and location of these charges is nearly the same, as you see. We did to be sure that our sensor is working well, we did two models of kappa opioid receptor, and we docked independently the same ligands. As you see, the location of these ligands is different, although it binds to the same groups. This is aspartic acid and the tyrosine, and the position of the ligand is stable, and there is no break of this bridge, indicated by this red line. And here there are some movies showing thermal motion of this complex. So you see the position of the ligand is stable. It is bound to helix 3. So these 2 residues, this one and this one. And guanosine group is interacting via ionic interactions to this glutamic acid on helix 6, although tyramine group is bound to helix 3. Another situation is two different models of opioid receptor with agonists. As you see, this tyramine group is bound to helix 6, and there is a break of the bridge between helices 3 and 7, here and here. And there is illustration. Position of the ligand is stable, and there is a break of this bridge. The first case and the second case. Here is the bridge. And now it was broken. And position of the helix is of the ligand is stable. It bounds to helix 3 and helix 6 here and here. It is well known that nearly all GPCRs are forming oligomers, oligomeric state. It was first discovered for rhodopsin in 2003, also with CRISPR-Chesky laboratory. And we built a model of such oligomeric state of rhodopsin, and we found that the interface is composed of helices 4 and 5. It was confirmed 2 years later by biochemical experiments. However, there is a second type of interactions by helices 1-to-1. And what is interesting in crystal structures of new receptors, adrenergic and adenosine receptor, only this type of interaction is visible. What is important for binding to G protein is also hydrophobic modification. For instance, rhodopsin has two palmitoid chains, but also G protein, which is composed of alpha, beta, and gamma subunits, has a very similar hydrophobic modification of subunits alpha and beta. And without this hydrophobic modification, there is no possibility of binding of G protein to the rhodopsin and also to other GPCRs. This is interesting that there are only a dozen of different G proteins, although there are about 800 of GPCRs. Therefore, such interactions are not very specific, although we still don't know the structure of the complex. This is extremely difficult to crystallize. Okay, and the summary. So microswitches act similarly in different GPCRs. This is known from many biochemical experiments and also recently from simulations. So our next step are cannabinoid receptors and other receptors which structures are available and will be available this year. Within 10 and for sure 100 nanosecond timescale, one can effectively investigate firing of single microswitches, and maybe what I shown you conjunction between two different microswitches. Of course, longer timescale are needed for seeing the movement of whole domains. So we need, of course, bigger clusters to investigate, but also maybe usage of a coarse grain force field, but with addition or atom representation of the ligand binding site is necessary. However, such methods are not available. So maybe in next year or two, we will see such method on the market. And the last one, but not least, global activation involves change in oligomeric state. It was shown this year by Brian Kobielka, laboratory, that oligomeric state is also changing upward binding of the ligand. So if this is agonist or inverse agonist, the oligomeric state of adrenergic receptors was completely different. So it means that for effective investigation of binding of the ligand, we have to involve also information about its oligomeric state. So really the size of investigated system should be rather big. And of course, the microsecond time scale is our aim, because only in this scale the full activation takes place. And let me thank especially my people, especially Michal Kolinsky, who did all these simulations. And this is part of my lab. Our collaborators, Chris Palczewski, Paul Park from Case University Cleveland, Daniel Miller, Tanush Sapra from Basel, currently also in Case University, and our recent collaboration, Frank Bernard Vorkel Deutsch from University of Frankfurt. And our financial support, Biocentrum Mohota, these are structural funds, and the recent grant, Marie Curie Action, within the 7 framework program. And thank you for your attention.
I know that there are many people in the audience who are not familiar with these type of studies.
So please don't hesitate to ask the questions that the things you're wondering about, even if you think that this is a naive question, but because I'm sure that many people would want to ask the same question. Philip?
Hi. In your simulations, you obviously have explicit water.
Right. Yeah. Yes, of course.
To what extent are those waters in your agonist and in antagonist binding pockets exchanging with bulk? Have you looked at that at all? Are the waters close to the agonist and in and antagonist in your simulations?
Fortunately, the binding site in opioid receptors is rather small. This is in contrary to the crystal structures, for instance, of the adrenergic receptor. Therefore, we didn't start from the adrenergic receptor because the structure of known adrenergic receptor complex is with inverse agonist, which is much bigger than typical agonist. Therefore, we should have to modify the structure. In case of opioid receptors, we investigated only the initial break of microswitches, and we didn't find any action of water, any bridging interaction of water. So this is why this system is very good as a starting point. Of course, for instance, for adrenergic receptor, I think the role of water will be much, much greater.
Can I ask another one? The structure you based it on was of the of the crystal structure you based it on had an inverse agonist bound. Is that correct? Or yeah. So
yes.
To what extent would that change anyway? Would you expect your structure to change anyway because you're not binding inverse agonists? If you see what I mean.
Yes, as I shown you at the beginning of this presentation, currently we don't know what is the normal state of opioid receptor. Therefore, this is hard to say what should be the starting point. We prefer the structure of rhodopsin, simply, which is the most inactive structure of GPCRs. Should be the starting point for investigations of early activation state of receptors. Because there is a zero activation level for opioid, upper GPCRs is not really zero, but it's about from 20 to even 50% of activation. So really rhodopsin is a very inactive receptor. In this case.
Thank you. Other questions? Mm-hmm. I know that many of those who are not familiar with looking at these type of simulations of movements or molecular dynamics, you will wonder what makes these molecules move. So that's something we can return to afterwards. Probably explain that. Yep. Yes.
Well, that's in line with my question. The occurrence of the different states of these molecular systems is highly dependent on the temperature, dependent on Boltzmann distributions of the population of states. To what extent are the transitions you are showing dependent on miniature changes in the temperature? How dependent is, the functionality of the system dependent on the temperature changes in real situations?
Of course, first we have to rely on room temperature. Therefore, we did about 20 repeats of simulations for each ligand to be sure that the binding site is the same. And for different temperatures, so far we didn't check what is the effect of lower or high temperature. And however, we did simulated annealing procedure for binding for checking the binding site of agonist and antagonist. So this procedure involved changing of temperature, and we started from 500 kelvins, and the temperature was gradually diminishing toward the room temperature, but it was done only for initial checking of the binding site. So we didn't use some commercially available programs for docking, we knew the binding site, more or less the binding site, from biochemical experiment, because the literature is very rich for opioid receptors, so this is why we also started from this case. And we simply put the ligand in between these helices 3 and 6, and checked, using this simulated annealing procedure, which is the final state for agonists and antagonists. So this was the source of our knowledge here.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
So as I don't know how many of you have a training in pharmacology, but in basic pharmacology, at least before, the action of drugs was often described in a kind of lock and key concept, where the drug is the key and the lock is the receptor, and you open, and so the key goes into the lock and the door opens and things happen. So the door opens is, of course, the cellular mechanisms that the drug elicits. But now we know that this is in one way false, because if the ligand was rigid as a key, and if the protein was rigid, or the target, whether it's a protein or a DNA, was rigid, there would be no action at all. So that the movement or the biological activity requires movements. And at least that is one take-home message from seeing these kind of simulations, that you have to have movements, otherwise you have no activity. Do you agree with me?
Yes, and especially in the case of opioid receptor, there are really small changes between agonists and inverse agonists and antagonists. So this is really a good example of such similarity in the structure and properties, and also this similarity in the function, in the action in opioid receptors. So we are happy that we succeeded to show such a mechanism.
When you look at the molecular structure of these receptors and the structure of the ligand next to it, you will see there is an enormous difference in size. And the question that many people ask is, how can this small neurotransmitter, for instance, make a change in this big receptor? And I like that, particularly that aspect of your talk with the microswitches. Sten?
So is it appropriate to say that you have, within the receptor, you have stiff parts that are sort of lever arms, and then you have parts which elements that are sort of movable in a sort of allosteric type of modifications. You have like lever arms and
we especially choose very stiff ligands.
Yeah.
Because we didn't know anything about early mechanism of activation of receptors. So this was our choice. The second choice is, of course, peptides, because peptides are endogenous ligands of opioid receptors. But unfortunately, they are many different groups, functional groups. They are very flexible, so it will be rather difficult to check the first binding site and then activation, mechanism of activation. So we will need very longer time scales. And for your question, maybe I come back.
Please be brief, because time is up.
Oh yeah. For instance, here, even the stiff part of the receptor is also changing, as you see. For instance, this this part, this is cyclopropan ring. This is, of course, very close to this bridge, but the presence of this cyclopropan is not helping, so it doesn't break. For instance, rhodopsin doesn't have this ring, and also this bridge is broken. So there are some movements here which is not known to us, because the time step is 1 femtosecond, and here we should integrate over nanoseconds. So this is really complicated how it is combined together to obtain such effects.
Thank you.
Okay, well, thanks a lot for this presentation.